I want to introduce you to Bart Accord. Bart completed his undergrad education in bioengineering at the University of Ghent, Belgium, followed by graduate and postdoctoral work in organic chemistry at the University of Rennes, France, the University at Albany, New York, and Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. Bart joined Johnson & Johnson in 1993. Over the course of his more than 20-year career at J&J, he worked in the areas of HIV, mycology, oncology, pain, inflammation, and metabolic diseases. Bart is a co-inventor in Intellence, a J&J first FDA-approved non-nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitor for the treatment of HIV. Bart is currently VP of Business Development for Merck Agency Income in the US, and he is also founder of Codiv, a consultancy firm for drug discovery and early development. And he is joining us today from New Hampshire, his favorite vacation spot. So Bart, thanks for being with us today, and the floor is yours.
Thank you, Elena, for the kind introduction, and thank you all for joining this morning or this afternoon, depending on where you are. So what I would like to share with you today is essentially a high-level summary of work that I did when I was still affiliated with Johnson & Johnson between 2012 and 2016. And as the title implies, so I started the natural product-based drug discovery program as part of what was at the time called within Johnson & Johnson was called the Janssen Incubator. And in fact, the Janssen Incubator was a home for interesting drug discovery ideas that really didn't fit the flavor of the day or didn't fit with the top priorities of any particular therapeutic area. We operated essentially as an internal venture, and to use a phrase that we unfortunately hear too much these days, but we were essentially quarantined from the rest of the organization. And that also meant that in terms of execution, that we performed all the science through external partnerships. All of the chemistry that I will be presenting was performed at Mercachem, and that happened before the Mercachem-Syncom merger. And for the biology, we resorted to partnerships with four different CROs. And on top of that, we also worked with two academic institutions. And I will speak to all of those aspects briefly in the course of my presentation. A couple of other things to mention, because all of this, the scientific material is a property of Johnson & Johnson, I won't be at liberty to disclose certain chemotypes and so on that we worked on because they haven't been disclosed in the public domain through publications or patent filings, so that I can unfortunately not show you. And also I should give the hardcore synthetic chemists a heads up warning that there's only one synthetic slide in this slide deck. And the reason why I organized it this way is because I want to spend quite a bit of time on the whole rationale behind this program that, as you will see, is quite unorthodox, if I can call it that way. And so I want to make sure that you understand what the reasoning was behind this somewhat different strategy. So let's dive into the science now. I hope you can all see my second slide. For those of you who are interested and have had an interest in natural product-based drug discovery, I trust you are familiar with these kinds of pie charts that have been published, I believe, the first time in 97 by Newman and Craig, both folks who were affiliated. I believe they're retired now, but they were affiliated with the NCI. And every couple of years, they essentially did an analysis of all the small molecules that have been approved by the FDA. And as you can see on this slide in the most recent publication, which dates back only a couple of months, they summarized all of they looked at all the small molecules that were approved in nearly, in the last nearly 40 years, so since 1981. And the total is just short of 1,400 molecules. And what is really remarkable, in my opinion, is that about a third of the approved small molecules are or natural products or our natural product derived. So you can see here in the top green wedge that about 5% of the marketed drugs that came to the market in the last 4 years are natural products in their own right. There's a very small sliver here of botanicals that was recently added. But what is still very, in my opinion, really remarkable is that more than a quarter of all of the small molecules are natural product derived. And it's even more remarkable given the fact that Big Pharma in particular has really reduced or entirely abandoned their investment in natural product-based drug discovery. So, if you want to learn more about all these other subdivisions, there's lots of content in those papers, and I suggest you check out the reference that's mentioned below here. Humans have, for many thousands of years, have recognized the power of nature to treat human diseases, or also in some cases for recreational purposes. And both the plants that are listed and depicted on this slide and the compounds underneath it are in many ways household names. So again, as crude extracts, these compounds have been used. I believe the first documentation around this is about 5,000 years ago. But for much of that time, they were literally used as extracts in teas, or people chewed on the leaves of those plants. But fortunately, with the advancements in scientific technologies and chemical technologies, particularly in the last couple hundred years, we've been able to extract, purify these compounds, also elucidate their structures, and eventually formulate them so that those of us in the Western world are fortunate enough to have access to these drug substances in pure form and properly dosed form. But it's fair to mention that I believe it's still the majority of the world population still doesn't have access to these APIs as we use them in the West. Another important point to point out, of course, is that these plants make all these interesting molecules, which we often refer to as secondary metabolites, not to treat human disease, of course. And they do this to help them survive and even thrive within the ecosystems that they reside in. So it's not surprising that the chemists quickly got to work and figured out ways to improve on the original natural products. And again, the structures here depicted on this slide, I believe are also, you're all familiar with them, they're essentially household names. And it shows that by tweaking these molecules, like at the top example, for example, just taking the natural substance penicillin G, you don't have to modify it all that much to come up with amoxicillin, which is still very widely and maybe one of the most widely prescribed antibacterial agents. My favorite example is the middle one, is the transformation from lovastatin into simvastatin. This little methyl group is the only thing that's different between the two molecules. I like to refer to this methyl group as the most lucrative methyl group in pharmaceutical history. The SOCOR, before it went off patent, was responsible for, I believe, around $3 billion in annual revenue for Merck. So showing that you don't have to make a lot of changes to a natural product to come up with something that can be quite lucrative. And I think all of you are familiar with the bottom example too, where Taxol was first isolated from nature, and docetaxel is obviously also a very important compound in the arsenal of anti-cancer agents. A couple of extra comments about this slide. As you can see, very often modifications are peripheral, I would call. They're minimal. And not surprisingly, the semi-synthetic compounds on the right, they are still an antibacterial, a cholesterol-lowering agent, or a tubulin inhibitor. And they are essentially also used in the same disease space. But it does show that chemists can contribute by taking natural products and slightly modifying them so that they become better drugs for the treatment of human diseases. Another aspect of natural products that I think is still too much overlooked is that you don't necessarily end up in the same biological space by tweaking the natural product core structure. And here I am showing which is only a small subset of all the steroids or the steroidal structures that are currently on the market. By my last count, there's at least 100 distinct steroidal structures that are used as medicines today. And the majority of those compounds are all derived semi-synthetically from the four building blocks that you can see here. Diosgenin is probably the most prominent one, and the structure is shown in the upper left here. Diosgenin is an important ingredient in the Mexican yam, and the Mexican yam has been used for centuries, if not longer, for the treatment of menopausal symptoms in women. But what I want to highlight, so the diosgenin in itself never became a marketed drug, but through semi-synthesis, one has access to this beautiful array of semi-synthetic analogs. And besides the diversity in the structures, I also want to draw your attention to the broad clinical range that these compounds cover. From, let me go back here, from birth control agents to here's the J&J drug Zytiga, which is a blockbuster drug for the treatment of prostate cancer, and you can see all activity in the inflammation space, in immune disorders. So this is something, from in my opinion, that is still under-recognized, that all of these interesting activities that are listed here for these marketed drugs, they are not necessarily predicted by the intrinsic activity of diosgenin. And that observation was for me a very important factor in my thinking and how I went about starting this natural product based drug discovery program that I will elaborate on in the rest of my talk. Just to make sure that you don't walk away from this thinking that I came up with this idea, I've shown you already examples, but this goes back quite a ways. The oldest example that I could find in the literature is the conversion of morphine to apomorphine, and that was published by Matthiessen and Wright pretty much 150 years ago. And there's a very interesting story behind this. In 1869, the structure of morphine was not known. The compound had been isolated, but nobody knew the structure. And what Matthiessen and Wright did as part of chemical degradation experiments, they essentially cooked morphine in concentrated hydrochloric acid. The molecule rearranges and generates apomorphine. What is also, what is equally remarkable, that one-step conversion from a marketed drug like morphine yielded another marketed drug, in this case apomorphine. And again, to emphasize the point that the biology can change in these transformations, whereas you all know, of course, that morphine is a powerful mu opioid, apomorphine now has no mu opioid activity anymore, but rather is a dopaminergic agent. And it's kind of an obscure compound, but it is used for the treatment of Parkinson's disease-related symptoms. Much later, in the last 15 years or so, people have been able to demonstrate that you can do exactly the same thing with thebaine, which is essentially a morphine precursor. So, for me, this is really an intriguing, an additional intriguing example, and it shows that when you play with natural products, you don't have to just limit yourself to converting penicillin G to amoxicillin, but you can really use these molecules, these natural products, as just synthetic building blocks and play with them chemically with the hope of entering novel biology in the process. And that's essentially what we ended up doing. Just before diving into what we exactly did, I want to also draw your attention to another under-recognized phenomenon, I think, and that is, and here I'm showing one of my favorite natural products called strictosidine. Most of you probably have never heard of strictosidine, for good reason, probably because it's not particularly useful for anything. There's no real no real biology or clinical utility associated with strictosidine, but it is a very prominent intermediate in the synthesis of secondary metabolites in a whole range of plant species, as I will show in a second. Strictosidine is very quickly synthesized in plants by, I mentioned here, L-tryptophan, but it really should be tryptamine, so the decarboxylated version of tryptophan. And it is condensed in one step through an enzyme called strictosidine synthase, with cyclogenine, a very abundantly available carbohydrate. What makes me so excited about strictosidine is that strictosidine itself is now the last common intermediate for a whole range of really distinguished natural products. The ones that I'm listing here are all marketed, all became marketed drugs in their own right, with the exception of camptothecin. For those of you who are familiar with the camptothecin story, camptothecin didn't make it to the market because it's absolute brick dust, but it became the direct inspiration for, I believe, about three closely related analogs that are made synthetically, including Camptosar. So for me, it's absolutely fascinating that in some of these compounds like quinine and quinidine, even for the trained synthetic or medicinal chemist eye, it's really even hard to see how to recognize the original strictosidine fragments in this final product. So depending on the plant species, depending on the environment and the ecosystem in which these plants reside, these the plants, with the benefit, of course, of hundreds of millions of years of evolution, they're able to make these beautiful and very distinct secondary metabolites. The other thing I want to emphasize on this slide is what's shown in red. And so out of this single natural product building block like strictosidine, compounds have been identified that are anti-infectives, compounds that are useful for cardiovascular disease, cancer, and even as a tranquilizer here with some CNS component to these molecules. So again, all of this is fair to say was completely unpredicted, and importantly was really not predicted by the intrinsic activity, or in this case lack of activity, of strictosidine. And for me, this picture really became the foundation of what I ended up pursuing. It was essentially the foundation for the venture that I started. And building on this image, so my idea was then, okay, why can't we as synthetic chemists choose a couple of natural products? And I'll tell you what the parameters were for the selection of those products. Play this with those natural products, and through bond breaking and bond forming exercises, and try to generate, not through plants, but in this case through creative chemistry in the lab, sets of novel, completely novel, three-dimensional scaffolds, essentially. The novelty bar that we set for those exercises was as high as you could possibly set them, these bars, because what we essentially required is that the novel scaffold had to, even the stripped down version without any definition of R1s, R2s, R3s, so any substituents on those scaffolds, that those scaffolds had to have zero hits in SciFinder searches, but even beyond that, also in MARPAT searches. And the rationale and the part of my pitch to senior management was that, look, if we perform this chemistry and we find any biology of interest, then we have absolute complete freedom to operate, and nobody will be looking over our shoulder. So I am an optimist by nature, but I did realize that starting with, say, two natural products and come up with eight novel cores, that in itself was a little too ambitious to identify novel biology. So we made sure also in this exercise that all these novel scaffolds contain two, or ideally three, that orthogonally protected diversity points, which were then which we could then elaborate in a library synthesis exercise and generate several hundred compounds based on each of those new scaffolds. A couple of words about what the criteria were for selection of the natural product. We ended up choosing two alkaloids for this exercise. The first one is scopolamine, and I'll show you one chemistry slide after this slide. The other one I'm unfortunately not at liberty to disclose. But what these two natural products had in common is that they were chemically complex enough that through these bond breaking and bond forming exercises, we would be able to generate scaffolds, novel scaffolds, that would not be that easily accessible through total synthesis. Another key criterion was that the natural product starting material had to be in, that production systems had to be fully in place. And by that I mean that we wanted to have access to kilogram or even ton quantities right away if we wanted to build on initial findings very quickly. The overall venture only lasted 3 years, so we could really not afford wasting time by working on a very interesting natural product that was only sourceable, say, in 10 or 100 gram quantities, and then we would have to wait for months to have that that scaled. That, so that was not, we could not consider those kinds of materials. Another obvious criterion was, of course, cost. And the reality is, of course, if you choose a compound like scopolamine itself is a muscarinic agent that is on the market for the treatment of emesis and motion sickness. So not surprisingly, the entire production systems are in place. The compound, in fact, is produced industrially from harvesting the leaves of the corkwood tree in Australia, but also, I think, more generally in Southeast Asia. So, because the compound has utility already, the production systems were in place, and that also, of course, brought the cost of the starting material down. Here you see a very much an unoptimized synthetic scheme that we pursued. It's the only one I can show because that's the only one that has been disclosed in a patent filing that is now in the public domain. So I'll walk you through this very quickly. I'm not going to go into detail into all the slides, but this is scopolamine. So overall, a pretty small molecule, which has a plane of symmetry, which will obviously lead to racemates at one point. Here, the first thing we did is we clipped off this ester. And in on this first row, what's essentially performed here is an inversion of the stereochemistry of this hydroxy group here, which is in the original scopolamine, is what I would call endo. And through Mitsunobu chemistry, we can invert this and get this into the exo position. And we also removed the N-methyl group and replaced it with an ethoxy carbonyl, which is, of course, a more attractive protective group. Next, we activated this hydroxy through the mesylate. You can use some other chemistry to activate this hydroxy, and then came in with sodium cyanide, which caused a displacement, which was not entirely stereoselective. Depending on the exact conditions, we had a 2:1 or 3:1 mixture of the endo over the exo, and really the endo was the only one that became of interest to us. At this point, we didn't separate those compounds, but we reduced the nitrile to the primary amine, and then that upon heating then ring closes through ring opening of the epoxide. Obviously, the exo form is kind of stuck and is essentially a dead end, which cannot lead to this additional ring close system. And then after benzylation of the basic nitrogen, we were able to separate it from the non-ring closed and benzyl analog. We then ended up installing a very bulky salo protective group on the hydroxy, which we learned was very beneficial in terms of efficiency in the last step chiral separation. We then, yeah, what we learned also is this ethoxy carbonyl really was somewhat of a bear to remove. And so we ended up clipping it off at this stage and installing a bock. You can imagine that when we went through a resynthesis, that we incorporated the bock from the start and shortened the synthetic scheme that's outlined on this slide. We then freed up the basic amine at the bottom, and these two enantiomeric scaffolds here were separated pretty straightforwardly through chiral chromatography. And we were able to generate about 50 grams of each. So after the whole methodology development, we went back very quickly and did larger scale synthesis. We ended up with about 50 grams of each of these enantiomers, and we were also able to generate an X-ray crystal structure on one of them so that we knew the absolute stereochemistry. So this is one of our scopolamine-derived scaffolds. As I said, it's the only one that's in the public domain right now. With some imagination, you can imagine that you can follow the same kind of concept and find other ways to tie up the bottom of the tropane system And that's essentially what led to the three additional scaffolds we ended up making. Based on this chemistry, again, we took two natural products. We generated four novel scaffolds based on each natural product. You can argue that in the case of scopolamine, we ended up with eight for the price of four because we were able to separate the racemates. And then we elaborated, so we introduced in general on these building blocks about five different R1s, then five different R2s, and a total of roughly 20 R3s. So every novel scaffold was enumerated into approximately a 200 compound library. And at the end of this approximately 1 year exercise, which was quite massive, of course, to get this all done, both methodology development, scale up, and library synthesis, we ended up with a collection of 1700 molecules. I know 1700 molecules is not a lot, particularly for those of you in the audience who are working on DNA encoded libraries. As I hope you will see, even that smaller number led to some fascinating findings through the biological screening strategy that we employed and that I will speak to now. So what did we do with these molecules? All 1700 molecules were entered into the Janssen/Johnson & Johnson compound collection. And they were profiled in all of the actively up and running molecular target-based screens. And I don't have to tell you, most pharma companies, that is their primary screening paradigm, is pure molecular targets, protein targets, or whatever. We also tested, through two academic collaborations, we profiled our compound collection in what we called model organisms, so embryonic zebrafish and Drosophila. Honestly, we had some interesting findings there, and not much that was all that tractable. If you want to ask me more about this, we can talk about that at the end. So I'm not going to focus on that. I want to spend rather more time on the cellular screens, which was really a very important part of our screening strategy. And the reason being, of course, if you can identify in meaningful and clinically relevant cell-based screens a certain activity, even if you don't know what the molecular mechanism of action is, you really can more easily convince yourself that you have something that really may be tractable. And finally, at the end of my talk, I'll talk briefly about what we did in vivo models also. I'm going to share two specific examples that relate to molecular targets. One of the areas that we tried to tackle as broadly as possible was epigenetics. So we did the chemistry in 2012, 2013. Around that time, I don't have to tell you, epigenetics had really taken off as an important new field in terms of drug discovery. And we ended up partnering with a company in the US on the West Coast called PPS Biosciences, and they had a pretty broad range of epigenetic screens up and running already at that time. And what we essentially did is, so we passed on our 1700 compound collection to them, and we, in consultation with them, we screened them initially against 16 epigenetic targets that covered a lot of the epigenetic space across eight protein families. So we covered some readers, writers, and erasers, and we screened them all at first at a single concentration, and that was kind of our standard way of working, 10 micromolar against all these targets. And frankly, not entirely surprising, this is how most of the results came back. So the way we always looked at activity was percent inhibition versus a particular target at 10 micromolar. And we looked at the various chemotypes. And as you can see, and this was unfortunately not all that uncommon, there was not a single compound in our collection, independent of what the scaffold was or the final R1s, R2s, R3s, that showed any meaningful inhibition. And I can tell you, as the medicinal chemist and the driver behind this project, this was an incredibly stressful time, of course, as we were waiting to see all these results come in. But fortunately, there was one epigenetic target where we did find some interesting and encouraging activity. And here again, what you see here is the activity for all the distinct compounds. 1A through 4B here are the four scopolamine derived scaffolds all in in sets of enantiomers, and then 5 through 8 are the four scaffolds from our second natural product, and then I also added a small cluster here that I had rescued from the J&J collection that also is very much natural product derived. So, and we also, of course, in all those screens included scopolamine and the second natural product we worked on. So what was intriguing in this case, sorry for the slides jumping back and forth here, what was very intriguing in this case is not only did we see some very encouraging starting activity with these one chemotype, and it was one chemotype only. Not only that, as I hope you can see this, the red dots in the blue box there all are so scaffold A with the same R3 attached to that scaffold. And I mentioned earlier, so we introduced about 5 different R1s, 5 different R2s, and in this particular case, we had 23 R3s. And not only did all the activity reside in a single scaffold, but by far, that one R3 clearly was also a pharmacophoric element in the activity, because many others that didn't contain that ended up being much less active or completely inactive. So all I can say about this target is that this was a completely novel epigenetic target. I think at the time we did the screening, there were at most a dozen scientific papers describing the compound, the target. And the tool compound that was being used at BPS Bioscience was pyridine dicarboxylic acid, which is not exactly a drug-like substance. And in their screens, they had to run pyridine dicarboxylic acid at 100 micromolar to see a meaningful signal. So what did we do then with these initial findings? We decided to profile the top 10 compounds against a bunch of more closely related, I would call them brother and sister targets. So here you see the initial percent inhibition of the top 10 compounds for against that unique target. And overall, as you can see from this table, the selectivity is quite reasonable, with maybe the exception of target 7, where there's some additional activity spotted, but not even for all the compounds. What was even more exciting is that the most closely related sister target, target 1B on the right, was completely wiped out at 10 micromolar by our compounds. And that too was a target for which there was really no small molecule inhibitors described. We ended up measuring IC50s for those compounds, and several of these compounds were sub-micromolar in terms of their activity. Our purpose all along in the venture was to show and demonstrate that through this kind of exercise, we could find tractable starting points for any drug discovery program. We didn't have the resources internally to drive this forward, but fortunately, our internal Janssen colleagues, who had an interest in epigenetics in general, they ended up taking in the project, and they started investing in the whole program. And for us, from a venture perspective, of course, this was our first kind of check mark where we could say, look, this is a methodology that can work. I'm going to leave the epigenetic story here for what it is. Another interesting finding we had was the profiling of our compounds against the novel neuroscience target that was being pursued by my European colleagues at the time. By the time they did an HTS campaign on this target, they used the entire Janssen compound collection, including our 1,700 molecules. And the collection at that time was about 700,000 molecules. The hit rate was about 0.7%, which is average for this kind of exercise, with just short of 5,000 compounds that had measurable IC50s. About 22 compounds had IC50s below 100 nanomolar, and believe it or not, 9 of those hits came out of our natural product-based efforts, and even the most active one, with a PIC50, as you can see, of 8.3, which corresponds to about an 8 nanomolar activity. So when we first got this high-level data set back, we were thrilled. All, yeah, by the way, all the yellow little dots here, yeah, are venture compounds. And so, as a medicinal chemist, of course, the next immediate question that came up as well, is this a random event over our library, or is this a chemotype-specific event? And as you can see, which was absolutely remarkable, is that pretty much all of the activity resides in one of two enantiomers of one of the scopolamine-derived scaffolds. So not only was it chemotype-specific, but it was just a single enantiomer. So, and the other thing that you of course get out of this is not a singleton like this compound. You have immediately a pretty nice SAR picture that you get from this exercise. Not only so did all the actives essentially belong to the one chemotype, but all of those, the most active ones, and these are the top nine compounds here in this list, all have the same R1s, and we installed five different R1s on this chemotype. There were three different R2s, and we installed five different R2s there, and there were only a handful of R3s that surfaced, and again we had put about 20 different R3s on this molecule. So this was just another fabulous finding. Just like what happened with the epigenetics program, all this information was transferred to my European colleagues, and they adopted this program then within the neuroscience franchise. So this was our second hit or check on our list of examples that this can really work. So I'm going to leave the cell-based screen, the molecular target-based screen story for that, because those were honestly two main highlights. And then we, as I already said, we really invested a lot, and I mean investing in terms also of dollars and time in cell-based, high-content cell-based screens. And obviously we looked at anti-infective activity and so on, but what I want to share with you is what we did in the inflammation and immunology and immuno-oncology space specifically here. What you see here, and I have to preface that I'm not the best positioned person to speak to the details of this slide because my focus was mostly on the chemistry, but I can walk you through this and give you at least a sense of how we went about this. So we were interested, and this of course came out of conversations with our internal colleagues in that, so what kind of cell-based assays should we set up? And we decided to put a matrix of screens together that looked at B-cell activation, macrophage activation, T-cell activation, and some others here. And I'll be focusing primarily on neutrophil migration, the neutrophil migration results. Importantly, and this was a key part of our strategy, which also obviously raised the cost of the exercise, but all these cell sources we used, healthy volunteers, and in some, in two examples, even cells derived from diseased donors. And the whole idea was, look, if we're going to do cell-based screens, we want to make these as clinically relevant as possible. Because of that, we used, wherever possible, clinically relevant triggers. And here in this column, you can see what the readouts were and what's the potential utility could be for compounds that would surface as actives in this screen. As we did in the molecular target-based screens, we screened all the compounds at the 10 micromole, with one exception, the epithelial to mesenchymal chemotransition assay, which the CRO suggested based on their experience with that cell type that we would screen at 20 micromolar. So I'm going to be focusing on our neutrophil migration inhibitors. And again, so the CRO did receive our 1700 molecules, and this is what came back in terms of overall activity profile. Again, on the bottom here, it's small, they're maybe a little hard to read, but these are all the chemotypes we pursued, including the two starting materials. And we looked at percent inhibition at 10 micromolar. Here is the 50% inhibition line in the neutrophil migration assay. And interestingly, in this case, we are not finding activity with one chemotype, but rather with two. both chemotypes, chemotype 5 and chemotype 8, were derived from the same natural product. And frankly, if I were able to show you the structures, I don't think you would be all that surprised that there may be some overlap in activities there, because these two scaffolds were architecturally much more closely related than, so they were much more different from scaffold 6 and 7 than from each other. So again, the same thing as we did with the target-based screens. Of course, we started generating IC50s, and we also had the benefit. Let me back up. So we ended up even doing in vivo work, as I will show you on a bunch of these compounds. But just to keep the data set a little bit smaller and easier to digest, I'm going to focus on additional activities that we generated or data points that we generated for three of the scaffold 8 compounds. So here are three of these active compounds. We took a range there near to complete neutrophil migration inhibition at 10 micromolar, then a second one that was showed about 50%. And in the following slides, I'm also going to speak to structurally very closely related analog that was inactive in the neutrophil migration assay. One of the nice things about our matrix approach to screening is, of course, that we got a very broad picture of the overall activity profile of any one of those molecules. So in the second column here, you see the IC50s that were in the low micromolar range for these three compounds. And as you can see, these are all these other assays that I described in a previous slide. And the top compound is quite selective and shows very little effect on any of the other cell types, whereas the second and third compound have much more of a polypharmacology profile. And of course, the question is, what do you do with those compounds? We ended up not really pursuing those much further, frankly. And I also want to highlight that the compound that was inactive in the neutrophil migration assay was also at 10 micromolars, really had essentially no activity against all these other cell lines. So in order to convince ourselves that this was a meaningful readout and that we would be able to move forward with those compounds, we decided to profile those molecules, these top three molecules, or the molecules shown here, in a mouse lung neutrophilium model. So what you do in these mice is you dose them with a compound, and 30 minutes later you treat them with the LPS, lipopolysaccharide, which causes a massive influx of inflammatory cells in the lung gavage fluid, which is experts refer to as the bronchoalveolar lavage fluid, the BALF. So should emphasize, because we didn't know that these compounds would be bioavailable or anything like that, so we decided to dose them first at 30 mpk IP. Here's the readout of the first results. So the total cell count in the BALF of these mice when they're just treated with saline is this level. You challenge those mice with LPS and you see a doubling of the overall cell count in the mouse. If you co-administer with the LPS or pre-administer dexamethasone, you see a significant drop in cellular influx in the BALF. And we were very pleased to see that these three compounds that I showed that I showed the data for on the previous slide at 30 mpk do at least as good as dexamethasone, which is kind of a standard of care. Obviously given at this point at a higher dose. So we're very pleased to see this, specifically because, remember, we were looking at neutrophil migration specifically. In a healthy animal, the neutrophil level in the lung is normal, essentially. This spikes up dramatically, of course, after an LPS challenge, is brought down with dexamethasone, and same thing with our three compounds. So not only is the total cell count is dramatically affected by our compounds, specifically. The next thing we did is we see like how low can we go dosing-wise with these compounds, and we ended up dosing them then at 10 and 1 MPK. Again, here are all our controls, and you can see here that at 10 MPK, we still see a statistically significant lowering of the neutrophil count. There's still an effect at 1 MPK for compound 1, but it is not statistically significant anymore. And the same we observed with compound 2 and compound 3. So all three compounds were still active at 10 MPK, but they were no longer statistically significant at 1 MPK. I showed you in the previous table the data for this very closely related inactive compound, and we were very pleased to see that this inactive compound, even dosed at 30 MPK, so at a much higher doses, that compound didn't show any reduction in the neutrophil count. And we also even verified circulating levels of the inactive compound and compared it with the active compounds. And if anything, there was more higher circulating levels for this inactive compound. But so all of this adds up beautifully and shows us that what we are originally identified in the human cell-based screen, that this repeats in animals, in rodents. We approached our lung disease experts in the company with these data, and they, on the one hand, honestly, they were very excited about the data, but they obviously, the question that they came back with, yeah, but how do you know in any way how this works at a molecular level? And obviously, that is not something we had any information on, and really were not very well positioned to, and didn't have the resources to pursue that exercise. Fortunately, our lung colleagues were able to convince their senior management to co-invest in this molecular mechanism exercise. The sad thing that happened, unfortunately, was that shortly after that commitment was made, the very top at J&J decided that lung disease was not a high priority disease area anymore. And unfortunately, most of my lung pharmacology and lung biology colleagues lost their positions in the company. So I think we generated some very interesting preliminary data here, but unfortunately these compounds, as far as I know when I left J&J in 2016, are still collecting dust and are not no further pursued, unfortunately. So I think I've given you a sense so far how we went about this whole exercise. This is definitely not the way most pharma companies operate, where they normally start with a molecular target and do lots of structure-based work and so on. This was obviously very different. I'm mentioning this now because the next thing I'm going to show you is even crazier. And what we did here was that out of the 1,700 molecules, we made 400 molecules, about a quarter of them, in 75 milligram plus quantities. And the only thing we did with those molecules before starting to profiling them in animals was making sure that we could formulate them properly for IP dosing. And then we put these animals, this was a massive undertaking that we initiated with a company called MD Biosciences, which does lots of, is essentially a pharmacology CRO. So they evaluated these 400 molecules in about a dozen animal models, acute animal models, not necessarily of disease, but acute models that allowed us to have to generate a behavioral or a biomarker readout. As an example, hot plate, where you can see what the withdrawal time is with or without administration of a drug substance. We also, in the immunology space, had certain triggers that we used, and then we looked at blood samples to look for interleukin levels, TNF-alpha, you name it. So it was a very broad exercise, and by far the most exciting thing that came out of this is that it was in the analgesic space. And we identified three compounds, all belonging to the same chemotype, same R1, same R2, but a different R3, that in a neuropathic, in a chemotherapy-induced neuropathic pain model, initially after IP dosing, but later we demonstrated also after oral dosing, was equivalent and even better than the standard of care gabapentin in this case in these neuropathic pain models. the results were so exciting. Pain at that time already was not a top priority for J&J anymore, in terms of, at least not in drug discovery. But the CRO, MD Biosciences, that we worked with was so impressed with these data that they negotiated a license to those three compounds to further pursue them on their own. Very quickly, we learned that that in fact the three molecules, same scaffold, same R1, same R2s, and different R3s, were quickly metabolized in vivo by oxidative removal of the R3. So the three closely related analogs essentially were quickly metabolized to a common metabolite that we believe is now is underpinning the very impressive neuropathic pain effect we saw. Just like with the cell-based systems, the biggest challenge, honestly, at this point became figuring out what the mechanism of action was. You have to understand that initially we didn't even know if this was a peripheral or a centrally mediated effect. And I know MD Biosciences has made good progress in that realm, but I'm not sure if they're at the stage yet that they've really pinned it down to start, if possible, on if it were a novel target or definitely whatever, if either target is not entirely novel, it clearly is a tractable target for the treatment of neuropathic pain, that they will pursue this. So they're hoping to pursue their own programs based on those findings. So that's pretty much all I want to share in terms of the science. I hope I've been able to convince you that this, what I would call very unorthodox way of starting drug discovery programs is meaningful. I really do believe that there's still tons of work to be done in the realm of natural products. And instead of going to the traditional, in the old days I would have said Sigma Aldrich building block providers, I do think we should go back to nature much more frequently, and not only semi-synthetically modify these molecules to improve the original biological activity of these natural products, but rather to access novel chemical space and couple that through to a very broad and opportunistic screening exercise that then can allow you, as I've demonstrated, to identify both novel chemistry coupled to novel biology. I'm very quickly going to acknowledge my two partners in crime, Sanjay Mistry, who joined us from the outside to serve as the venture leader, and Snehal Naik, who joined us at the time from Pfizer to lead all of the biology. Obviously, as I said, we were quarantined and operated independently, but I'm very grateful to all the many interesting and very informative discussions with both therapeutic area and functional area colleagues. Big thank you and kudos to our external parties. Merckagem did just an unbelievable job, not in terms only in terms of productivity, but creativity. And I'm thrilled to be part of the Merckagem Syncom team today. Also, a big thank you to our biological profiling partners. I want to point out that if you are interested in this overall approach, by all means, check out the wonderful work by Paul Hergenrother and his group at the University of Urbana-Illinois. In January 2013, Paul Hergenrother published in Nature Chemistry a strategy that is incredibly similar to what we started a year earlier. And if you're interested in that, how natural products like the steroids can be converted into other marketed drugs, in this case, that have very different biological profiles from the original starting material. Check out a perspective article that I published and wrote for JMedChem in 2016, where you see that this is not a one-off or a two-off. It is a very common phenomenon that I still believe is very much underrecognized. I'll leave it at that at this point. I'll turn it back over to Elena, and I'd be happy to answer some questions.
Thank you, Bart. It was a great talk, very inspiring. And we actually have a lot of questions, so we will just start right with the questions. So if you were to start a new project, which natural product would you choose? And do you think this kind of project is applicable for smaller companies with fewer programs?
Several good questions. I mean, I think what we did not consider at the time is any fermentation-derived products. So I think I was kind of biased by my 20 years at that time in pharma, and I had always worked on nitrogen-containing compounds, so I chose alkaloids. But I think that it can be broadened widely because, as most of the audience knows, I mean, nowadays there's fermentation technologies that allow people to crank out very fascinating molecules in also in kilogram quantities. So I think the primary driver, I think, should be twofold. Should be chemical complexity and interesting chemistry. So obviously polycyclic systems, systems that really would be very hard to access through total synthesis. And always keeping in production systems in mind, because if you find interesting activity, you want to be able to go back to the source and purchase, literally like we did, kilogram quantities of these molecules. In terms of the biology, I think it's really difficult to justify an exercise like that if you don't want to be open-minded. If you are, so I had, before I got this even off the ground, I would propose this to the East Coast leadership, and they would say, well, we're doing metabolic disease here is a key priority. Can you guarantee that you will find things that will be useful in metabolic disease? And I had to be honest and say, no, not at all. So I would say, if you, I think it's a very worthwhile exercise, but you have to be very open-minded, kind of wait to see where the chips fall, and then pursue and build your expertise up around where you saw the initial activity. So you have to be open to casting the net very wide from a biology perspective.
Okay, thank you. Why was the SAR biological profiling outsourced to a CRO, and how was the experience?
The experience overall was very good. First of all, I mean, we worked with various companies, and all of them were incredibly focused. Why to a CRO? Because we really wanted, I mean, believe it or not, even in a big pharma organization, we screen much broader than J&J ever does at any one time. And the other thing that we kept in mind is that if they're screening already, they will probably find lots of other interesting starting points internally, and sometimes the complexity of the molecules that we identified was a little scary to many medicinal chemists. So we wanted to have full independence. And speed of execution was very much part of it. As you know, I mean, when you partner with a CRO, I mean, and this, so these exercises were quite sizable. So we became an important partner for them, and they were very much on top of things. So I think we were able to execute much faster by working with CROs than working with our colleagues internally.
Thank you. Yep. And besides purification, what are the challenges in generating large natural product libraries for large-scale HTS?
You mean, yeah, I'm not so sure if I understand the question correctly. Purification, I mean, obviously, we did not deal with extracts. Eh? I mean, mm-hmm. I mean, there are companies that are specializing in selling both pure natural product libraries or mixtures. So I'm not so sure if I get the question fully. So we didn't have a purification problem. You can see that once we chose the natural product, which we sourced in pure form, all of the chemistry afterwards is not different from what is being done in any chemistry or medicinal chemistry lab anywhere in the world. Yeah, and we use just standard technologies in terms of chemical conversions and purification.
Well, I guess then the question will be if there is any particular challenges in generating large natural product libraries for high throughput screening.
Well, yeah, I mean, I would say, look, our libraries were small really because of resource and time constraints, dollar constraints and time constraints. I mean, if one of the things that I've always thought about and shared with many of my colleagues, These scaffolds can be incorporated in, some of these scaffolds for sure can be incorporated in DNA encoded libraries, and you can really generate millions of molecules that way. So I think our collection was small because of the time constraints and the dollar constraints, but I don't see, once you have the novel scaffold and the chemistry is scalable, as we were able to demonstrate, then you can crank out tens, hundreds of thousands of molecules. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. Yeah. So are there special considerations to take regarding IP, proving inventive step and non-obviousness when making subtle modification to a known natural product? So for example, adding just a methyl like simvastatin.
Yeah. I mean, well, I don't know what Merck's patent filing strategy was. I didn't mention, from what I understand, the additional methyl group in the statin series is Zocor stabilizes that ester bond and allows simvastatin, which was a twice a day dose drug, to become a once a day dosing drug. And that, of course, is from a marketing perspective very attractive. That was a fundamental difference, and again, I don't have insight in the Merck patent strategy, but clearly they were able to claim that as an inventive step, which allowed them to have unique access and rights to the molecule for the entire patent life. So you don't have to tweak things a lot, particularly what we did, of course. I mean, The final chemistry is so different from the natural product that there's absolutely no issue in terms of interference with the rights to the natural product itself.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. We're actually running out of time, so we have to stop it here. But I want to invite all the people that submitted questions and we didn't have time to reply. Please send it, contact Bart through LinkedIn or send us an email to info@merkahemsingham.com and we will come back to you really as soon as possible. So we have to leave it here today. Thanks so much, Bart, for joining, for stopping your vacation also to be with us today. And I hope to see you all on August 26th. We have a webinar on electrochemistry. We will be talking about sono oxidation in the synthesis of sp3-rich scaffolds with Wouter Nieuwestraten. So I hope to see you all there. Bye, and thanks for being with us today.
Thanks for listening.